And I think there's also a transition point in life where you got to look and go, how many people that I'm around need me? How many people that I spend time with need me? Versus how many people do I spend time with rise me up, stretch me, edify things, make me feel, you know, like I could do more and want to and help me get there. This changed my life because Rich and I know this guy who's probably clinically insane. And
you think?
So I show up to speak at this event, Rich is there, and Rich is in the room, and this guy introduces me as owning all the skyscrapers in Utah. Now, at the time, I owned 45% of a three-story building. I don't know if a three-story is considered a skyscraper, but I don't know, and it's definitely not all of them in Utah because I own none of the buildings downtown. And then he says, every speaker here is a client of this guy's. Now, some of the people there were like Jack Canfield and Tony Robbins, and I was like, I've never even met these guys, let alone had them be a client.
My favorite is when he had us all hold hands in a circle and asked you to GQ Jesus to pray.
Yeah, that's a good part of it too. So he makes this introduction, I walk out on stage and I go, I don't know who's just introduced, I look forward to meeting them or maybe becoming them one day, because that was like the best thing. And then afterwards, we go up to his room. And it's Rich and it's another guy and me, and the other guy's actually slamming him, like just hammering him. I was like starting to actually feel bad for him. And he's just conceding on everything. You're right, I got carried away, all this kind of stuff, right? So we go back and I do another gig. But right after that, you know, he held hand because he's like, oh, Rich is from Utah, Garrett's from Utah. They must be into like group prayer and this will show them I'm like, so we do this holding hands prayer thing. And then the next time he introduces me, because I think he thinks I'm Mormon because I'm from Utah, but he also must be confused with Catholicism and Mormonism because I don't know that Mormons really kneel down and pray like Catholics do. I'm not quite sure, but he goes, yeah, the last time I was with Garrett and his wife, we just kneeled down and prayed together. And I'm going, this man is insane. We have never kneeled down and prayed. We held hands strangely the one time and he asked me to give a prayer. So in that moment, I was like, rather than go fight with him, like, if you fight with insane people, you're insane.
Yeah.
So I just created this three categories. Friends are people that I'll do business with, I'll invite to everything, I'll move mountains to try to do things with them, and if I can't, I'll let them know, please invite me again. It doesn't work with my schedule. Like, they're my cheerleaders, they're the ones that want to see me succeed. It's the phone test. Like, I always think of Roberto with the phone test. Like, I want to answer Roberto's call when he calls, because he's going to be like,
Embono!
You know, yeah. He's got that big energy. Same with Rich. Like, so there's those calls that you get, you're like, this is awesome, I want to answer this call.
Yeah.
And then there's other calls you get, you're like, you know? Like, so yeah. The phone test is one. The second thing is buddies. So buddies are people that you love spending time with, maybe you like to go hunting or fishing with them, but you would never jump into business with them.
Okay, yeah.
Like, I have this friend, my wife's listening to him talk. He talks big and he's pretty wealthy. And at the end, she goes, are you gonna do all that with him? I'm like, no, I did business with him once. It was, I did 11 of the 12 steps. He did one of the 12. And then when he was supposed to reciprocate, he did none of it. So that was a pretty clear sign that we're just gonna hang out and, you know, we're buddies. And so she's like, oh, that makes sense. And then the third category is friendly. Friendly is like the person that introduced me that was insane. Rather than arguing with them, rather than try to change them, rather than waste all my time and energy, all I simply do with them is go, no thanks. I don't share anything important in my life. I don't share my vision. I don't share what's really going on. Small talk and short talk, right? I could be cordial and pleasant, but I'm not gonna invest any time. So I'm looking at how quickly can I be in and out of the conversation and move on. And like I just saw someone that I fired years ago. Just saw him, he was at this event as I was the keynote Friday, and he was like one of the paid sponsors to be there, and he's telling everyone he's financially free, even though I know he was not financially free, unless he maybe married into financial freedom, I'm not sure, because he left his wife when she was having their sixth kid to get married to another woman, and I'd fired him before this, thank God. But when I saw him, I was like, not talking to him. I gave him a nod, wasn't gonna shake his hand, wasn't gonna get in any conversation when he tried to initiate. I just simply said, oh yeah, I'm here talking to Brad, you know, hope you're doing well, and just moved on, right? I wasn't mean, I didn't get in an argument, but I was really calculated that I'm not spending any time or energy with them. So the people that you get friendly with, it's super helpful because you just don't waste time. I remember coming home from Italy after we spent 2 months there, which is very calming and relaxing and, you know, low drag, no, like it was no drama for us. And I came back and I just noticed one relationship was he's addicted to drama, 100% of the time in drama, wanting to drag me into drama that's not mine. And because I was hypersensitive, I'm like, ooh, got to move him to the friendly list. And there's a few people that I moved to the friendly list. So I'm like, there's a chance they could move to the buddy list in the future, but they're not going to jump to the friend list. Like, you know, like I'd be fine spending time with, but definitely want to be really calculated and careful. And I just found that in my 20s, I just tried to change people that don't want to be changed. Or, you know, like it's like someone making a political post on Facebook. How many minds did they change for that post? You know, people are pretty stuck in their mind when it comes down to it. So who do you align from a value standpoint, from a vision standpoint, who wants to see you succeed, who supports you succeed in succeeding? And I think there's also a transition point in life where you got to look and go, how many people that I'm around need me? How many people that I spend time with need me? Versus how many people do I spend time with rise me up, stretch me, edify things, make me feel, you know, like I could do more and want to, and help me get there. And there's, I just see that there's a saturation at a certain point on the rise where you go, like when I brought Norm in, and even at a time when I brought Rich in to consult me one day, this was like 09, 2010, they were both like, man, you got a lot of people riding the coattails and you're dragging a lot of people along, which creates a drag for you. I think that there could be an upgrade. I think there could be a shift. And that's a hard thing sometimes because relationships are dynamic. There's a lot of emotional baggage that can come with it. There's a lot of connection. But the reality is if you're going to rise, there is going to be people that move to different categories during that time. Dan Sullivan has this thing, which is the four levels of competence. So the bottom level is incompetence, which obviously we know not to do things we're incompetent at. Then there's competence, which sometimes people do what's competent because it's convenient, because they don't know someone else to do it for them, or because it saves them money. But in the long run, it costs them and it drains their energy. The third level is where the real trap is. It's excellence, where you don't know anyone that can do it better than you. But that's where a new skill set of finding people, even if they're close to you or 80% of what you can do, it makes sense to give up things that people can do less efficient than you, but they're a lot less of a price when you're paying them versus the price you pay for doing it, and reserving your time for where you're most unique in. Because unique will actually, you'll gain energy, it's what you do that no one else could do, it's that unique combination. And so part of the reason why we're back to this framework, and by the time that we're done tomorrow, when you're with Rich, we'll have 3 to 5 initiatives of like what you're really up to.